Congratulations. So here's the prize, Mr. Knight.
Thank you very much.
I can hold.
Thank you very much, Jan. First of all, I want to thank the Vilcek Foundation and the scientific committee for this great honor that really came to me pretty much as a complete surprise. That's probably the best way to get one of these prizes, as a surprise. And I want to thank also the words of John Massagué, who introduced us. Whatever little I have accomplished in my work could not have been done without Sylvia, who has always been by my side in this now long journey, providing support, help, patience, understanding, and love. It's also an opportunity to thank my children who are here, Fernanda and Carlos. Them I robbed many Saturdays and Sundays and weekday evenings where I would go back to the lab to try to get that elusive result or maybe try to obtain or repeat that exciting experiment or simply try to get that next version of the paper, the manuscript that we were working. To both of them, my love and gratitude. We scientists work with the illusion that we are the owners of our destiny, that we essentially are doing what is, in a sense, unavoidable. And yet, I often think that many times in our work, we come to forks in the road, to places where we have to take an alternative, where the road diverges. And it is seldom that we actually know what we are doing when we decide to take one of those roads. And in fact, it is not possible to do the experiment, the alternative experiment. What if I would have chosen this other road? But we do, and we do it usually not for rational reasons, but for reasons of the present circumstances, gut feeling, and emotional reasons. And so, in fact, I often think that it's interesting that we scientists who think that are rational beings oftentimes behave more like what a biophysicist, and forgive me the expression, would call a Brownian particle executing a random walk. I think that there is a lot of randomness in our decisions, and we are random walkers under a drift. For those of you who are initiated will understand. I had to make those decisions in 1980 when I finished my PhD at UC Berkeley, and I wanted to go back to Peru, my homeland, and went back. But unfortunately, the country had started its 10-year war with a guerrilla, a Maoist guerrilla, that unfortunately led to tens of thousands of Peruvians dead. And obviously, didn't need biophysicists at the time. And so it was not possible for me to come back to my homeland. But fortunately, there was always the possibility of coming back to the US. And that's the decision that my wife and I made. We came back and decided that we will make this our country, that we will learn to love this country, and I think we have done that, and we think it has been for our best as well. I also want to thank here, I think it's appropriate, my many students, undergraduate, graduate, and postdoctoral students. You see, I think that there is only one subject that is more interesting than molecules and cells, and that is human beings themselves. That's the greatest mystery that we actually have to deal with in our daily lives. And I think that it's a real privilege to witness every day in my laboratory as these young scientists come to my lab and they have the same light in their eyes that I think I had when I became in love with science, and they want to create and they want to make their first flight of imagination, and they want to make their first steps as scientists. And I think that it is really inspiring to us, to all of us, to those of us who are scientists in the room, to actually realize that they keep coming, and even though they look younger and younger every year. Coming to the United States, and I'm going to finish with this, represented a lot of experiences that were sometimes very shocking. And I will relate you actually a funny one that happened to me just when I had come from Lima to Los Angeles, where I was engaged in a six-week crash program in English. You may think that it didn't help, but believe me, it did. One of the weekends that we spent during these 6 weeks in UCLA, there were people from all over the world, Indian, Japanese, South Americans, you name it, Europeans. They told us you are going to spend a weekend with a typical American family. And so, well, we were excited about getting to know a typical American family. As it turns out, actually, my typical American family, the man of the family, was a vice president of Exxon Corporation. So I got a very distorted view of America right from the start. But there was an Italian man in this group. And in fact, he got invited to a blue-collar family. And so on Sunday, when we came back from this experience, having spent one weekend with a typical American family, we were all curious to know what had we experienced, of course. And we asked Claudio, this Italian friend, how was your experience? And said, he said, it's very strange. They gave me prepared food. It's not cooked food. They bought the food prepared, and they cook it in the oven, and they gave it to me. And they sat me then in front of the TV, he said. Really? And so what were you watching? Oh, very strange, a very strange game. They call it football, but they don't kick the ball. They don't kick the ball. Everybody, of course, there were Argentinians, Chileans, Peruvians, many people from Europe, Spain. And so we said, that's strange. They call it football and they don't kick the ball. That's strange. Well, in fact, there is not even a ball. They use an egg. He said, an egg? And what do they do with the egg? Well, they throw the egg. And what happens then? Then they form a human pyramid in the field. A human pyramid. Yes, they go on top of each other. They said, that's strange. And then what happens next? Well, they keep forming human pyramids all over the field. It's a very strange game. So who wins the game? I think the team that forms more pyramids wins the game. So we said, that's very interesting, strange. Americans are really strange. And then he said, not only that, at the end of each game, they go like that to each other and said, to insult the other team. No, within the same team. So we were thinking, you know, try to do that in soccer. It won't work. So anyway, I did survive that first experience in the U.S., and you can tell that actually everything was uphill from that point. I want to finally finish by thanking the many friends that are here who had come and accompanied me, my brother-in-law, Lucho, who came all the way from California, the ambassador of Peru to the United Nations, Maria Cecilia, who I haven't seen in a long time, who we went to college together. Actually, she was in high school when I was in college. Everybody who had been willing to come and attend, my colleagues at NYU and universities here in the Northeast, thank you very much for this great honor.